So thank you everybody from across the world for joining in on this presentation. It's a new experiment for me, so this will be kind of exciting. So one of the things I wanted to talk about is that I'll talk about one of our specific sub-technologies, but my lab is really about biomedical micro devices and building essentially small integrated technologies to serve either the clinical or the biomedical research. And one of our goals is really to make useful technologies that others can use. So we often spin these out into companies. Some of these you may notice, Protein Simple now markets small-scale protein assay technologies. Cell Microsystems is our array sorting platform. And Altus Biosystems will market the technology I'm going to tell you about today. So as we start out, we're coming from across the world, but one thing that's quite clear in this time of COVID is that drugs are essential for many. And in fact, in the US, we really love to take our drugs. 55% of the Americans take prescriptions regularly, often an average of 4 different drugs. And so it's absolutely necessary for life and life quality for many. But there's a big problem. And that as we begin to develop, try and develop more and more drugs, it's really quite costly. The cost per drug is skyrocketing. And if you can look at some of the latest company data, it's up to one drug is almost 12.5 years and $1.5 billion. So it's pretty prohibitive, and there needs to be other ways to design and develop drugs. The high cost is due to the high failure rate as drugs enter clinical trials. Something like 90 to 95% of the drugs will eventually fail and not make it into humans. And some of it has to do with our model systems are just not really where they need to be. They're not accurate and precise. So often we're using tumor cells as a screening technology, and really tumor cells aren't like humans at all. We often use rodents. In the US, you're required to do some mouse tests. But again, rodents are only about 30 to 70% predictive of human outcomes. So really, our current model systems are just not very good at predicting which drugs will be bad and which ones will be great. So we'd like to have better assay systems. And of course, we can take a look at airplane technologies. No one would train a pilot on a bicycle or an automobile. Instead, we have flight simulators. So why not do this for our drugs? We'll train them on real human organs. So we'll make human organ simulators. We can even connect these together and have a simulated human. The idea is you'll use fewer mice, you'll kill fewer humans on the way to drug development, have fewer bad outcomes, and really better, faster prediction, and hopefully a lot cheaper drugs with better information. So some of the things we need to look at as we develop drugs is making sure we get the design criteria right. As with any kind of technology, we want to know what the specifications are, and really how do we rebuild an organ. And typically what we want to do is simplify it to the degree possible and recapitulate the tissue, the minimal unit of the tissue function. And then we can do that in high throughput screening, et cetera, as opposed to build a whole gigantic human organ just for a screening purpose. So some of our specifications, as I'll show you, we're now converted 100% to human primary cells, both stem cells and differentiated cells, no tumor cells, and no mice or other animal cells, just human. We'll get the right sort of supporting materials and scaffolding to support our tissue subunits. It's pretty critical that we get the architecture correct so that we really begin to accurately mimic the physiology. And sometimes the architecture is quite critical in getting the physiology correct in the biochemistry. And part of this is the ability to implement chemical gradients. Most of our tissues are polarized. They may have an apical and a basal side. They may have a luminal side. And there may be specialized compartments within that tissue, for example, where stem cells reside or where differentiated cells reside. And these some degree are controlled by chemical gradients. So we'll want to get all the microenvironment chemistry correct. And then if need be, if we think this is a major driving force for this particular tissue, we'll try and get mechanical forces and shear forces correct. So my favorite organs happen to be the small and large intestine. They do all kinds of really quite amazing things, and I'll touch on both of these quickly. We'll start out with the large intestine, though, because it's in some ways maybe a little bit simpler than the small intestine. It has a very, its main job is to store waste and digest and absorb food. It also is a site for a lot of drug metabolism. And it's probably one of its most important functions we now know is as a culture vessel for the microbiome. These bugs really help us digest our food. They convert drugs to toxic or non-toxic forms. The drugs actually can secrete a lot of agonists or regulators for the human body. So let's take a closer look at the intestine. This is the large intestine again. And some of the really kind of interesting things are, this is the epithelium of the large intestine. And there's a lumen, so this is where the waste would be stored. And then the basal side are the blood supply side. And then you can see there's this really beautiful array of what we would call a colon crypt. So it's invaginations down from the epithelium. Part of the beautiful part of this epithelium is this top surface here is all differentiated cells that live about a week and then die. So they're out there facing a stunningly harsh environment. So they're by destiny not going to be very long lived. But down at the base is where there's a nice protective stem cell niche. And the stem cells that are going to live with us for a lifetime are very sheltered and they can replicate very quickly. Their offspring can migrate up the crypt and replace these fully differentiated cells. And this is just a close-up of one of these crypts. There's actually an open lumen here that's hard to see from the tissue slice. And then the red marks the differentiated cells and the green the stem proliferative cells. We're going to use humans. So we're not going to get a lot of material, so we'll also build out technologies so that we do get a very small biopsy with about 100 crypts, we'll be able to scale the material and build our systems. So let's look a little bit closer at our intestines, and it turns out the small intestine has quite a few bacteria, not that many density-wise. And it's basically an aerobic compartment or hypoxic, but definitely not anaerobic. The large intestine, though, is just literally crammed, jam, packed with bacteria. Over 400 species, and the vast majority of these are obligate anaerobes. That is, they'll die in the presence of oxygen. So it's kind of a really unique microenvironment where the stem cells are fully oxygenated down at the base of the crypts. But in the lumen, there's very few molecules around. And what little there is gets scavenged by a few of the facultative anaerobes that are in the lumen. There's all sorts of roles of these bacteria and the immune system education, metabolism. About 20% of our 20% of our calories come from energy salvage or fermentation in the colon. Neurotransmitters secreted in the large and small intestine that regulate mental function. And then a lot of the drug metabolism occurs. And it's very clear now that given that the gut and its microbes really controls much of the human physiology and biochemistry, some of the next big drugs are going to be in manipulating these microbes that live inside us so they head us in a more helpful direction or prevent diseases. So this is what we're going to rebuild. This is our intestine now, our crypts, our nice crypt. It's about 500 or so microns long and about 150 microns wide. The basal or blood surface, the luminal surface where the food or waste is stored, stem cells down here, and differentiated cells up here. Protecting the cells is a very thick, robust layer of mucus. So I'm going to show you how to build a mucus layer. And then the lumen, as I mentioned, has to be anaerobic for the bacteria to live, while the stem cells remain highly oxygenated. So a very steep oxygen gradient over just hundreds of microns. In addition, there is a ton of other chemical gradients that help maintain the stem cell niche in this polarity of the crypt, where there are differentiated cells up top and stem cells at the bottom. So stem cell growth factors like Wnt or spondin and noggin at the base of the crypt, differentiated factors at the top of the crypt to support the differentiated cells, for example, BMP. And there's a whole host of other gradients, inflammatory molecules, cytokines, food metabolites that play a regulation of our physiology. And also, in addition to oxygen gradients, there's quite a few other gas gradients likely. So we're going to rebuild all of this on a microscale device. First of all, before I start out, I also like to pitch that we have a whole range of technologies. What I'm going to show you is our more complex 3D technologies, but also I encourage people, specifically biologists and pharma companies, when thinking about the system you need, always pick the simplest system that replicates the feature you would like. Because as you get more complex, the cost goes up, the scalability goes down, the information content goes up, but often one of these far simpler systems will support your needs and you'll have a lot less pain and more reliability. So we have very thin-coated surfaces that have only differentiated cells. That's a very popular system around the world. A lot of others have worked on this also. We also have some scaffold-based systems with a collagen matrices so that you can have a mix of both stem cells and differentiated cells if you want to see what the stem cell behavior is. And then finally, I'll show you today our molded nice 3D complex models. So ongoing applications in the lab, you can imagine, cover a huge number of areas, but I'll talk mostly about the microfabrication and the technology today. And the other thing that's really cool is you can build banks of these tissues now from people of all ages, sex, races, different disease states. So it's a very, very rich model system using primary human tissue. And as I'll show you, you can begin to replicate some pretty amazing features. So existing formats, we try and make a lot of our simpler formats in line with biologists, the technologies biologists are already using. So often in a 96-well format, so it's highly compatible with existing machinery and workflows. And then we have a number of more scalable platforms where you can screen arrays of gradients and things like this. So we try and do both, but make a range to cover a number of uses. The other thing, again, as we mentioned, we want our human cells to be really nice, happy, well-behaved human cells. So we really make sure there's a luminal basal or apical basal polarization in the intestine. That's critical because absorptants, nutrients flow in a universal direction and waste are excreted. So they need to have, for example, integrin beta 4 down on the basal side, actin up in a carpet of microvilli up on the upper side. We also want to make sure in our primary cells, we have every single in vivo cell type that's present in a normal living human. So we've got lots of colonocytes that are very active at absorption, and you can see this carpet of microvilli off to the right side here. We also have plenty of goblet cells making mucus. We have the hormone secreting cells, also our intraendocrine cells and other types of cells in our systems. So the first thing we want to do is really begin to shape this three-dimensional system. One of the pieces of work we pioneered was developing a scaffolding, the same scaffolding that would support both differentiated and stem cells of the intestinal epithelium. So that's a ton of work, and I won't talk about any of that, but after we got the model system going, we could then begin to think about shaping a scaffold, actually growing the little green cells here that you see are the human stem cells in green. So we can grow a very stem proliferative rich cell culture across the scaffold. Then we're actually going to design it so we can apply chemical gradients across the scaffold. And what this does, will create a really nice stem cell region or stem cell niche that's rich in growth factors, and the stem cells can only live here. This enables the cells up here to differentiate once they escape the influence of the Wnt or Spondin and Noggin. We'll also design this so we can have oxygen gradients. So a normoxic stem cell compartment, but an anoxic luminal compartment, and really hypoxic, fully differentiated cells. As I'll show you, we can also have a range of food, and microbial and metabolites also across the system. So how do we do it? We start out pretty simple. We actually build it on a transwell. We sand off the bottom of the transwell. We put our own porous membrane. It turns out not all porous membranes are the same. We put an impermeable film on part of it and create a diffusion window. We pour in our mold, and then we put in a PDMS stamp or other stamp. And then we can make it semi more rigid, a little more solid, and ability to support the cells. And then we'll pull out the stamp, and we've got this beautiful crypt array. It's at nearly the same density, and these invaginations are the same shape and size of a human colon crypt. And we've got this nice diffusion window under here so that we can create chemical gradients between the luminal and basal compartments. So again, we can build these on a whole host of platforms, 12-well, 24-well, 96-well, and then some of our more customized higher throughput platforms. This is what one of these molded systems looks like. So about a 3-millimeter diffusion well, and then you can see a fluorescein labeled scaffolding, and there's the nice little crypt structure. So we'll grow our cells across it. After we grow the cells across it, you can see they actually form a beautiful monolayer growing down into the crypt well, so they don't pile up on top of each other like a tumor cell might do. And so that looks pretty good. You can see a little bit of bare scaffold over here, and then the cells here growing down into the crypt lumen. So this is looking from on top. You can actually yank these in vivo crypts out of the scaffolding, and this is what they look like. And so you can see they're really beginning to look like an array of invaginations lined by a monolayer of primary human intestinal cells. Now what we're going to do is apply a gradient of growth factors. It's trivial in the system. You add the Wnt or Spondin Noggin to the basal compartment, whatever you want to the luminal compartment, and set up a nice standing linear gradient. The luminal and basal compartments act as infinite source and sink, so long as you change the media every 1 to 2 days, and you get this nice standing gradient. So very simple and easy for biologists to use. And these are what our polarized crypts look like. The green shows the stem proliferative cells, and you can't yet see the differentiated cells, but I'll show you that. Again, now here's a slice through a crypt, and the KRT20 shows the differentiated cells in red, and again, the OLFM4 marks the stem proliferative cells, so you have this beautiful physiologic-looking colon crypt. This is what a slice of human tissue looks. You can see we're missing the blue, the nuclei and the stroma, but if you look at the crypt itself, we have a really a nice, beautiful crypt. These cells, we can measure all the metrics like SOX9 and other markers of either stem proliferative cells or differentiated cells, and the markers all show up in the right place. We can look at the top of these arrays. So this is a projected image looking down on top of the crypt array. You can see the EDU or green marked cells are down deep into the crypt, so they appear as little circles. And then the red marks the colonocytes or differentiated cells. We can look at between the little crypt regions and see these beautiful columnar, fully polarized colonic epithelium, Ezrin and the microvilli, integrin beta 4 along the scaffolding sides. We can also pulse them with EDU and show that while the stem proliferative cells start here, as they differentiate, they migrate up the crypt and replace the differentiated cells as they themselves differentiate. We can track the speed, play with the gradients, make this flow of cells from the stem cell niche to the basal, to the differentiated cell zone faster or slower on the shape of the chemical gradient. Then we can begin to do some nice 3D confocal imaging and other types of imaging. So this is, again, a projected confocal view. We can look closer up and see now we're looking from the bottom. This is the basal side of a crypt. This is the luminal side where the red is. You can see it differentiated cells. And this is the very top of this planar array in between the crypts where you can just see the nuclei stained in blue. And again, you can get side views and projected views and play with these. And then really each crypt in its stem proliferative cells becomes an individual unit that can be assayed and analyzed. You can create all sorts of gradients, more than just the Wnt, Arspondent, and Noggin. This is a gradient of short chain fatty acids, acetate, propionate, and butyrate. These are the major products of fermentation of fiber in our large intestine. Millimolar concentrations in the intestinal lumen, but very, very low concentrations at the stem cells. And I'll show you why in a bit. So if we have just our control crypts looking from our top view, and then acetate gradient has very little effect. Propionate has also little effect, but you can see the butyrate has a stunning effect. And if you look from a side view of the crypts, you can see this even better. The butyrate really pushes the differentiated cells to form, mostly colonocytes. And this is actually their major source of energy. And it also suppresses stem cell proliferation. So you can see on the far right, there's very little proliferation in the stem cell compartment, but very nice, strong alkaline phosphatase staining are a differentiated cell marker. We can also put these nice gas gradients, develop COMSOL models of the gas gradients shown here to show that our basal reservoir is highly oxygenated, luminal reservoir is nearly completely anoxic. This is what one of these devices looks like. We do this by shaping the materials and changing the oxygen permeability of the surrounding material. We can just look and show that the luminal compartment is indeed deoxygenated and the basal compartment has a nice physiologic oxygenation. We can look at tissue adducts that form in the presence of deoxygenation. So you can see the top of a crypt, that's this red, but very little down in the bottom. We can actually begin to grow. This is a facultative anaerobe growing on the crypt system, and you can see the beautiful lactobacilli on top of the little microvilli. And Clostridium difficile is an obligate anaerobe. It grows very well in the luminal compartment when it's deoxygenated, but it secretes toxins, which is very hard on the cell, but nevertheless a really nice model system to study C. difficile toxicity. So now we can have our gradient factor and then our growth factor, our oxygen gradient on top of it. And we get these beautifully polarized crypts with the stem proliferative cell at the bottom, then the deoxygenated and differentiated cells at the top. We can also show that the oxygen gradient has a fundamental impact on stem cell behavior. It actually, in some ways, replicates the effect of butyrate and decreases the proliferation of the stem cells. So again, all of these gradients have very profound physiologic consequences, and one can imagine that damage to the colon really disrupts these gradients and makes the physiology these create wonderful model systems for disease processes and intestinal damage. Our mucus layer, most systems before we started had no mucus layer. So these are just 1 micron beads. If you put them down onto the array, they settle right down onto the epithelial cells. Here's EGFP stain E. coli, again, sitting right down on top of the blue stain nuclei of the epithelial cells. We've developed a nice system now to create a huge physiologic mucus layer. So 0.02 micron beads can permeate the mucus layer, which is shown here. These are the nuclei or the epithelium layer below, but 1 to 5 micron beads and larger cannot permeate the mucus layer. We can show that the E. coli also cannot permeate this deep, deep mucus layer, several hundred microns in thickness, so the same size as about a physiologic human mucus layer. Our mucus layer is very thick. We can make it as thick as we want. It's very goopy, and so you can see this really nice viscoelastic muck, if you will. It has all the right proteins. It has mucin 2 as the primary component, but it's all got also all these antibacterial peptides, as well as other types of mucins we'd expect to see in the colon. And again, the barrier function is really quite excellent of our mucus. There's actually a thin filmy layer up top in the mucus and then a more dense compacted layer on the bottom. We can also show that it's quite physiologic. We know that in vivo, the mucus plays a major role in blocking epithelial cell inflammation. So if we take our crypt cultures, we put white blood cells on the bottom, E. coli on the top, and then look at how inflamed the system becomes, you can see it just goes crazy. So here's with no E. coli, with E. coli, we get huge amounts of chemokines and all sorts of cytokines being created, IL-6, IL-8, and then a vast number of others. The white blood cells go crazy. The epithelium gets really pissed off also. But if we just add in a mucus layer, we basically obliterate all of that inflammation. We can also show that toxins like C. difficile toxin don't permeate the mucus barrier very well. So it's quite physiologic. So I'll go pretty quickly in just a few minutes to show you our small intestinal model. Again, the small intestine is really much like the colonic system, the human colon. Beautiful crypts with the stem cell compartment at the base. These long villi, which are designed to increase the absorptive area of the small intestine. And then really now this compartment has a lot more oxygen in it with a mixture of obligate anaerobes and facultative anaerobes and even aerobic bacteria. So now we're gonna do a same mold. This is our mold system. This is the villi. This is actually the reverse of the mold for the collagen. And these are the crypts down here. The villi are the same sizes in humans as are the crypts, the same size and nearly the same density. This is just looking on top of the mold in the diffusion window as sliced through the molded system. And you can see these villi project up and these crypt holes project downward. Now we can cover this with a human small intestinal epithelium and begin to impose gradients. If we just do a Wendt-Arspondon-Noggin gradient, we can see kind of a stem cell compartment, but really no differentiated cell compartment. There's no red cell as being marked here. But this is what they look like from a top down. So you can see we're looking through the villi and then down into the crypts. A slice through, and you can see it's a pretty decent small intestinal epithelium. Got a nice stem cell crypt compartment, a mono layer cells covering the crypts. You can see them in this nice cross-sectional slice, but no differentiated cells. But fortunately, we can start staining for different markers, and we can see that we have some nice polarization in the actin and microvilli. We can actually add another gradient. This is a DAPT gradient, so something that really promotes differentiation to try and get our villi cells differentiated. And now we can see some much more differentiation up in the villi. This is a bright field image of one of our villi and then the crypt, the fluorescence, and now you can see this nice red on the differentiated cells. This is kind of a side view of part of the array, and you can see these nice wavy crypts. Again, we can do a cross-section, and we can see KRT20, the differentiated cells up in the villi themselves, OFM4, the stem proliferative cells down in the crypt zone. And this is a slice through normal human intestinal tissue. Again, differentiated cells marked by KRT20 up on the villi, and then the stem proliferative cells down in the crypts marked by OLFM4. And again, we can show that the cells, if you pulse them with EDU, they start in the crypt But then as they proliferate and differentiate, they migrate up to the crypt villi. We can play with the gradients, track their speed, slow them up, speed them down, that kind of thing. So basically, I hope I've shown you that these organs on a microscale are pretty cool devices. We already have a number of projects just looking at fundamental intestinal physiology and how the stem cells repair and differentiation are regulated. But on the other, on the clinical side, there's huge opportunities in terms of drug side effects with co-culture of microbes, et cetera, drug screening. Again, we have now a whole system. I talked to you about our 3D systems, but we have all these other model systems. And this is the team that has helped do all this work. I actually haven't done any of the work except for the big ideas and input. So it's really this group of people that deserves all the credit. The work that I've talked about was by a group of seven different talented people who you can see highlighted in the yellow group. And then finally, everything is done with a team of other people, clinicians, and now at UW, a growing list of collaborators also. And I have to thank the National Institutes of Health for paying the bill on all of our projects. So with that, I will stop now.
So thank you very much, Nancy, for an absolutely fascinating talk. We have a bunch of questions here from the audience. Let's start with the Q&A panel. We have, and I'm sorry for mispronouncing these names, but Shreyesh Jain says, how do you prevent PDMS mold sticking to the scaffold? Any special activation of the PDMS?
Yeah, it's passivated. So we have to coat it. Otherwise, it'll stick in the collagen, the scaffolding, or just fragment as you pull it out. So shoot me an email and I can shoot you the paper. The paper is in cellular CMGA, cellular molecular gastrohepatology. But if you shoot me an email, I'll point you to that reference. Yeah, it has to be passivated and made non-sticky or it's a disaster.
Okay, great. The next question is from Amy Herr. She says, thank you very much for the exquisite microfluidic systems, and can you comment on the potential for including mechanical forces like undulation from both the biological and microsystem design perspectives?
Yeah, so Amy, spot on. Great, another great question. We actually, I didn't talk about it. We have a whole system now that exerts shear forces to the colon. So if you think about the colon, it's a storage organ, and it kind of sits there and it has some small undulations, but not much. But once a day or a few times a day, it has a big squeeze, if you will. So we actually now have a system that we're designing, a very simple, easy to use system that recapitulates that kind of physiology in humans. So the colon doesn't, the flow is literally close to zero in the colon. So you don't want high flow rates, but you want a high shear force episodically every, 24 hours or so. And so we're actually recapitulating that kind of system. But a great question.
Okay. Next one's from Dinty Hazenbrink. Says, thank you for your interesting talk. At the beginning of your talk, you recommend that when designing an experimental setup, keep it as simple as possible. Do you have experience using different types of cells, mimicking more complex stacked layers of cell types?
Yeah, so that's another great question. So I didn't show you any of our systems. We now have systems where we include immune cells, where we include myofibroblasts and other types of supporting cells. So we've just begun working, adding in multiple cell layers for the intestine, but also have some collaborators we're working with to actually link it to other organs, like the liver is the main one that'll be really exciting. So you, as you can imagine, food gets absorbed through the large intestine then flows straight to the liver where it's metabolized. So there's a huge interest in a liver, a gut-liver system, and we've got collaborators, actually Alan Wells up at Pittsburgh is the major individual we're working with to build a multi-organ system.
Okay, great. Next question, Giovanni Nocera says, maybe I missed this part, but what is the scaffold material used here?
Yeah, so the scaffolding material, it's a collagen, but it has to be specially prepared. And again, if you want to shoot me an email, I'll show it to you. We do all of the our cell maintenance now on a very soft neutral pH collagen that we fabricate, and we actually incubate it to pre-wash it. And then for the 3D structured system, it's a cross-linked version that has to rigidify the collagen. And again, it's got a human layer of a human collagen layer on top of a rat tail collagen layer. So if you shoot me an email, I'll also shoot you those papers. It's a modified collagen, but we work pretty hard to get the collagen just right. If you don't prepare it, a number of things can go really wrong. One, the collagen falls apart. Two, the cells don't make a nice monolayer. They begin to grow on top of each other in organoid kind of weird format. So you have to be very careful in how you prepare the collagen. So I'd be happy to point anyone to our papers that detail that, as well as supply other people with any kind of information they want in terms of like detailed protocols and things.
Okay, next question is from Angela Wu. She says, super cool system. I'm curious about the proliferative behavior of the cells in the system compared to in vivo. How do the differentiation rates and turnover times of the crypt cells compare to in vivo, and do the stem cells remain stem cells for an extended time?
Yeah, great question. So our proliferation rates are very similar, and the migration rate up the crypt is very, very similar to that in vivo. And you can actually make them go faster or slower with gradients. And we've kept our human colon on crypt for 30 days. So the stem cells were all looking quite happy down in their stem cell base, our stem cell niche. So there's not a problem there. The when we no longer grow any of our human primary cells as organoids, we grow them as monolayers on the neutral collagen. But you can interconvert them between organoids and the monolayer system. So we have a paper out in CMGH that details that the monolayers exactly replicate the organoids just in a flat format, but they maintain the stem cells. And we've done lineage tracing, for example, to show that the stem cells in the monolayers can form all of the different cell types. We are very careful, whether organoids or monolayers, not to keep them beyond passage 15. A lot of people will maintain that these systems will live infinitely, but what we found is if whether we grow organoids or monolayers, it doesn't matter. At some point, they will begin to accumulate chromosomal translocations and other aberrations just from being grown in vitro. So we're very careful to toss them after P15, but even from one small biopsy, if you grow them to P15 and freeze them, you know, grow them to P1 or passage 2 and freeze them down, you'll get years worth of cells. So it's a very nice resource.
Okay, so the next question is Calum Thurgood Parks. He says, really great talk and truly fascinating. Have you considered or pursued developing these crypt replicants within a flow system for inflow analyses and replicating mucus movement?
Yeah, great question. We actually have begun to do that, particularly on the small intestine. So we're working on it for the large intestine, where there's a mechanical shear force across the mucus. And then for the small intestine, a small intestine actually has a very high fluid flow rate. So physiologically, to have a really nice small intestine, you'd like a very high fluid rate. So right after you eat, you have high fluid flow through the length of the small intestine. And then as you fast, it slows down quite a bit. So we're building a system to replicate that. And in the small intestine, the mucus is single layer and it's very flimsy. So we're working hard. It's actually harder to build a mucus on the small intestine, remarkably, than the large intestine, which is a little bit easier, probably because it's static and things don't get diluted as much. But spot on, there's nothing to show anyone yet, but those are both projects in the lab.
Great. Next question is from Jane Colbrook. She says, fascinating talk. Have you grown cancerous colon crypts?
Ah, yeah. So we just started that also. You guys are hitting on, now all my secrets are out. Yeah, so you can imagine one of the big things is look at stem cell biology, clonal wars down in the crypt, that kind of thing. And so we, since moving to UW, we've started up some collaborations in that direction. And some of the things we want to do is get the system just really robust and bomb-proof so that we can port it over to biomedical and clinical research labs, and it's just another tool they use, and they don't have to worry about our system, you know, being one of the variables in their assay. So that's a big goal of ours. We're working on it again, but don't have anything yet. But you're spot on. It'll be beautiful, I think, for looking at colon cancer.
So next question is Lewis Olguin. He says, could you tell us if you started to test with drugs in your organ on a chip?
Actually, yeah. So what we've done is more what the pharma companies have been interested in. And our sense is the low-hanging fruit is more the monolayer systems, where we've actually looked at the drug transporter molecules as well as the drug metabolism molecules. And we've looked, we've done both human and small intestine, large intestine and small intestine, primarily the small intestine, because that seems to be what others are most interested in. But we can show all of the drug transporters are there. There, the scaffolding is absolutely critical. And if it's too rigid, you won't get the transporters being expressed, much to our surprise. So you have to get the stiffness right. So, but we've got a couple of papers out showing that there are drug transporters and they're very active. Most of the major classes are there. We've got both protein mass spec analyses of the systems, as well as RNA analysis. And we've also looked at drug metabolic enzymes, and they're there also, and you can actually measure their activity, et cetera, with real substrates.
Okay, great. Well, Nancy, there's still more questions, but we're out of time, so I really encourage everyone to get together with Nancy during the Meet the Speaker half hour that's coming up a little bit later. Thank you again so much. That was outstanding.
Thank you.